Right. General Nick, since President Biden's announcement, the Taliban have made dramatic advances. Is it time for the West, the Americans, to rethink their approach when it comes to Afghanistan?
I think not necessarily. I mean, I'm a firm believer that the Afghan security forces that are there and the government as a whole are capable of holding on to those bits of the country that really matter. And I think that's important that they do that, because if they do that, there's a chance then I think the Taliban are more likely to come to the table, because they'll recognise that they have to find a political compromise. And I always go back to the ulama announcement, the Council of the Joint Religious Councils, about 6 weeks ago, which happened under the aegis of the Grand Sheikh, where the war was declared illegal. And I think the moral high ground can be seized by the Afghan government if they're able to hold on to those key bits of Afghanistan at the moment.
In your view, though, do the Taliban care about legitimacy or whether something is illegal or not?
Well, I think we're, of course, making a mistake of thinking the Taliban's a homogenous entity. And as you know, just as well as I do, they're not. And indeed, there's probably quite a disconnect between what happens in the political commission in Doha and what happens in the various bits of the battlefield of Afghanistan, where the military commission in all its guises is doing its own thing. So I think we need to be careful not to judge it as a homogenous entity with a single set of political objectives. And I bet you, with the amount of success they appear to be having on the battlefield at the moment, that they will be riven with division, because they'll be wondering who's going to be in charge if they win. So I think it's quite difficult to predict any of that.
Do you think then the political office in Doha is redundant?
No, I don't. But I think it'll be interesting to see how it tries to bring the rest of the movement together with it. And I think we should be watching to see how that happens. I'm also certain that there's a big disparity between what the political commission, in particular Mullah Barada, is saying in public and, of course, what he's actually doing, wandering around, doing a bit of diplomacy in Russia and China. And there's a big disparity between that and what's happening on the battlefield, where we're seeing atrocities being committed, we're seeing war crimes being committed, we're seeing women being brutalised, we're seeing forced marriages, all the sorts of things that the Taliban were notorious for in the past. And there's a disparity there. So I think that needs to be called out.
I met them in Doha and they told me that this time it would be different, that they have changed. Do you believe that?
That may be what the political commission's saying, but the facts on the ground, I'm not sure they prove that just yet.
The UN says they still have strong links with Al-Qaeda. What's your assessment?
Well, we're hearing, aren't we, that Al-Qaeda-affiliated fighters are being used on the battlefield. So I suspect that's probably a pretty fair assessment. I mean, it remains to be seen how this plays out in the longer term. But let's face it, if we end up with a scenario where state fractures and you end up essentially with a security vacuum, then there's absolutely the ideal conditions for international terrorism and violent extremism to prosper yet again.
Would you then, as a friend of the Americans, ask them to reevaluate?
Well, I think all of us who've got an interest in Afghanistan will need to reevaluate if that occurs. But it hasn't happened yet. And I think that we need to be really clear that if the Afghan people can stand together, if we can show a bit of unity, and indeed the sort of defiance that I think we saw on the streets of Kabul and indeed on the streets of Kandahar last week, then there's no reason to suppose that that necessarily will happen in that way.
Are you worried this could turn into another Rwanda or Srebrenica?
I mean, I think if we end up with it becoming a security vacuum and we end up with the chaos that comes with those sorts of vacuums, all things are possible. But I think we have to be talking away from that. I think we have to be getting behind the Afghan government and its people at the moment and encouraging them to show unity, to show defiance, and to show confidence in their security forces, and to hold on to those provincial capitals that fundamentally matter to the Afghan government's legitimacy.
A lot of people would be asking, we've poured billions into this country, why can't the Afghan National Army hold some of these districts and provinces?
Well, I think a lot of it depends upon the will to fight, and what we need to see is that defiance. And we've seen that in Lashkar Gah, where Sami Sadat, the core commander down there, I think has fought very courageously to keep the Taliban at bay. The city is not yet, of course, under the control of the government, but it shows that it is possible for the Afghan security forces to significantly diminish the efforts of the Taliban. Indeed, the Taliban have taken a lot of casualties during this period, and it's possible, but they have to fight.
The Americans didn't consult so much as inform Britain that they were going to withdraw. Do do you feel the White House gave a fair hearing to its allies?
I think they spent a great deal of time working out what decision they should make. And let's face it, it was not an easy decision to make. You know, we've been at this for 20 years. It is America's longest war. And of course, it's right and proper that the leader of a country like America has to consult his electorate. And his electorate, I think, are pretty positive about the decision that he's made. So these are difficult judgments to make, I would suggest.
But the Americans talk a lot, especially this administration, about transatlantic relations. Shouldn't they have informed or at least consulted Britain better?
Well, I think, you know, it's a NATO mission. It's not just about Britain as an ally. And the answer is that there were regular conversations going on in NATO about all of this. So I don't think it necessarily came as a surprise. I mean, I'm on the record of saying it wasn't necessarily the decision that we hoped for. But of course, it is an example of the US thinking about its new strategic posture and what its place in the world needs to be. And we have to respect that as allies and partners.
As you say, it wasn't just the Americans, it was NATO, it was all democracies. What sort of message do you think this then sends to Russia, to China? Does this embolden them when they look over the border and see that the Taliban have defeated these countries?
Well, let's see what happens. As the Americans might say, the fat lady hasn't sung yet in that old film. The reality is that we don't know how this is going to end just yet. And it is entirely possible that the facts have been changed on the ground, and through changing the facts on the ground, Afghans can end up resolving this for themselves. I think what is a more important question to ask is a question about the regional neighbours and how they play into this, because they've got a role to play in encouraging the region to seek peace and for peace to happen for the Afghan people as a whole.
Many people now, experts, analysts, the Afghans themselves, continue to point the finger of blame at Pakistan. What's Pakistan's role and responsibility in all of this?
Well, Pakistan, of course, has lived with this challenge for many years. I mean, ever since the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan. And the reality, of course, is that they've got between 1.5 and 3 million Afghan refugees on their soil. And they have had for many, many years now. So from their perspective, they are absolutely invested in whatever the outcome is going to be. And certainly in my engagements with my Pakistani opposite number, General Bajwa, you know, I'm in no doubt that he is very genuine when he says that he wants a stable and moderate Afghanistan on his northern border, because of course that will contribute to stability in Pakistan as well.
And the intelligence that comes out that says that the Pakistanis have sanctuaries and have created a safe haven for much of the leadership of the Taliban, including the Haqqani network.
Again, I think you have to always look at things from other people's perspectives. And one of the challenges the Pakistanis, of course, have is with so many Afghan refugees on their soil, which I think we would be very worried about if they heartlessly kicked them out. The reality is, of course, they're going to end up, aren't they, with all sorts of people in amongst those refugees. So it's quite challenging for them, I think, to be able to prevent that from happening. Now, the fact that they have built a fence now along the border and they are trying to control the movement back and forth across that border is, I would have thought, a step in the right direction. But it is a much more complicated problem. It's essentially a political problem that has to be solved.
You've played an important bridging role between the various partners and people and leaders, including regionally as well. What do you hope to see now?
What I'd like to see, of course, is a conversation amongst Afghans, which leads to clearly a different Afghanistan, but one that represents the wishes of all Afghans. That surely is what we should all be hoping for.
Do you not see this unfolding into a terrible humanitarian tragedy in the next weeks and sort of months to come?
Well, I think we've already got a humanitarian tragedy. The question now is whether it gets worse or not. And so much of that depends upon how the parties now behave and whether or not the Afghan government can bind together the population that it governs still to provide real unity and real confidence and a real sense of purpose to be defiant. And if they can do that, then there's every reason to suppose that the parties will have to come together to talk about the future at a table.
And finally, if the Taliban do overrun the country and take it by force, will that become a problem for the West?
I mean, I think there's a big question about their legitimacy when that happens and whether the West still wants to support Afghanistan if the Taliban have seized the country in a fashion that is quite obviously illegitimate. I think that would be a very difficult question for governments to want to answer. But I'm not sure. Do the Taliban really want to become a pariah state again? I'm not sure they necessarily do. I think what we have to watch is the extent to which the Taliban holds together in a homogenous way, and whether the words that the political commission are talking to at the moment end up being the reality that appears on the ground.
But do you genuinely think they care about legitimacy?
I think they don't want to become North Korea. I think they know that they've got Afghan people now who have seen over the last 20 years what it might be like to have a flourishing media, a civil society, education, women at work, women in government. I think they've seen all of that. Now, I hope that if trying to govern all Afghans, they will take account of those Afghans who form that civil society.
So you've accepted that there is a possibility that the Taliban could come back to power in Afghanistan?
Whatever may happen, there surely has to be a political compromise. And whether that means a Taliban government, whether it means a government in which power is shared, that remains to be seen. It very much depends upon what happens over the next few weeks on that battlefield. But if a military stalemate is achieved by the current Afghan government and the people of Afghanistan are defiant and unified behind that effort, then there's no reason to suppose that you can't end up with a political compromise which works for the majority of Afghans.
General Nick, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. It's not a homogenous organisation. And of course, you've got a lot of very young radical elements on the battlefield who are, you know, going to do what they always do. The political commission wants to see happening, but it is happening. And somehow that has to be put back in the box. Yeah.